welcome our next speaker, Manal Zeinedine. Manal Zeinedine, are you there, Manal?
Yes, I'm here. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening. And in fact, the flow of thoughts, the stream of thoughts is going from one speaker to another. We spoke about organizational culture transformation, the importance of emotional intelligence, and Dr. Edna exposed the situation and the challenges we are facing in the violent post-COVID era. And now you are going, Manal is a global education consultant, and I think you are going to talk about adapting value chains for conscious educational gains.
Yes.
So here we have values, and hopefully we have gains, so
yes,
opportunities.
Yes.
So we are coming to the positive side of our conference.
Yes.
Go ahead. The mic is with you.
Thank you. Okay. So good day, everyone. I'm so delighted to be here with you today on the platform of the Leading Global Socio-Economic Forum of 2020. I would like actually to wholeheartedly thank the International Academy of Management Sciences and Property. I would also like to thank Dr. Mohammed Assadani and Dr. Hala Al-Minyawi. Dr. Hala has been incredibly kind, actually, and inspiring, gathering all those speakers from all around the globe to discuss the potentials, challenges, and expectations of the post-pandemic era. Dear fellow speakers, warmly welcomed attendees. When I first started my journey as a grade one teacher back in 2000 in Lebanon 20 years ago, what I was thinking about was how to design my classroom to welcome children, how to design my lesson plans to teach children, and how to manage classes to engage children, and how to also adapt to my tasks as a typical teacher. So the scenario was pedagogy, curriculum, assessment, activities, self and time management as well. So my learners and myself were my only focus, my only responsibility. Moving up through elementary classes 5 years later here in Saudi Arabia, more middle school classes and high school classes, the scenario continued to be pedagogy, curriculum, assessment, activities, self and time management. And consequently, my learners and myself were my only focus, my only responsibility. With humbleness, I proudly say that I excel because I was literally discovering and living a passion of myself. The educator who merged love for reading, for writing, learning, and self-expression with the sheer excitement of sharing that with the community. Why and how? Educators can easily relate to that. It's the inborn joy in us to create a path for ourselves and to create a path for others. It's this joy to stare in us the wonder that the sky is the limit, and giving and caring to the moon and back. Now, this might sound poetic, but that's how I've always visioned myself as an educator. However, when I was entrusted to be a head of department, which is a leadership position, a decision-making position, I was thrilled. I thought about applying all my teaching strategies and all those engaging practices for joyful learning and outstanding outcomes. And that was even more thrilling. I started building plans in my head, discussing that with teachers, steps and procedures to execute them, until I discovered that reaching the sky was not as easy as it seemed, and that we might not even be able to launch a rocket to the moon. I did reshape the department, achieving multiple replicas of successful classrooms, highly engaged learners, and excited teachers, but there was a missing link, actually. There was a missing link that I could not decipher at that time. Now, 5 years later, as when I became a director, the same challenge continued to be, and it was even more challenging, because I was in a senior leadership position, and it was actually a senior leadership position when you would be doing what everyone would dream to be, so in which teachers would be teaching wholeheartedly, regardless of any limitations, grow professionally and joyfully, in which also learners would be doing what they are in schools to do, to learn excitedly and be happy, to be also in a school where senior leaders, including myself, would do what they were to do in a school, support holistically, grow professionally and joyously, and as well in which school owners would be fulfilling all their requirements, would be very satisfied and thriving all the way through. To those who are wondering how this narrative relates to the title of this talk, Adapting Value Chains for Conscious Educational Gains, I could actually list the following. Point number one, COVID's pressures are more than we can handle. So now more than ever, we have to mitigate all problems. Point number two, education to educators like me, and I'm certain there are thousands and thousands who harbor the same passion, are there in schools not just for a job and a salary, and that learners and staff have the right to fully enjoy being in schools. So here, I would like to share with you the science of learning and development, or SOLD, in which we can see that the whole child has the right to grow academically, cognitively, ethically, physically, psychologically, socially, emotionally as well. I would also like to share with you a version of teacher development framework embodying ORBITS, or ORBITS, the interdisciplinary through transdisciplinary approach that I have developed throughout the years. Point number three, when map and terrain differ, follow the terrain. Our aspirations cannot be always easily fulfilled. But as professionals, we must be realistic, but with grit, resilience, and innovation. Anything can be molded to make a better reality, almost anything. That's why imagination and innovation are keys. So I was a teacher and an academic director who studied education and language in the university. I do not speak as a business administration degree holder, because I am not. What I did was researching diligently and independently basic business concepts. When I felt sometimes tied to budget constraints in schools, and then when I felt unable to put those advanced school improvement plans in action, so I had to investigate and find answers. I leave financial planning to those who are equipped to do so, but I'm here today to set a value-driven framework that is measured from a holistic educational perspective. And point number five, this talk does not aim at criticizing owners, investors, or stakeholders. We all share responsibility and accountability. But today I cast the light showing the values of educational institutions, which both investors, owners, proprietors, potential investors, and stakeholders can understand and optimize. So there are two main questions that arise here. Can both stakeholders and shareholders meet at common ground? Yes, they can. And can we survive COVID? Yes, we can. So let me first address the shareholders, represented for-profit schools and potential investors. Now, private schools are not always founded by passionate educators who have a dream school in mind. Sometimes businessmen are advised to venture into this kind of investment in education when advised of the high profits you know, in this type of industry, referred to as educational service industry, a term which I personally do not like to use, but as professionals and thinking in realistic terms, working in the field, this is reality in terms of operations. So we have here educational services offered through human and material resources, which necessitate expenses and naturally generate profits. Can we then consider that schools are organizations that have the same value chain, just like any other industry? In technical terms, yes, they do, but in essence, they do not and should not. So a business model referred to as value chain that was initiated by a Harvard professor, business school professor Michael Porter, mainly states that to understand firms, we cannot just look at them as a whole. Understanding schools or organizations or businesses stem from the activities a firm performs from start to finish. So analyzing the activities classified as primary and support activities, actions can be adjusted to meet targets. So this is from a business vantage point in which we see more emphasis on operations and products. In education, and after 20 years of being in the field, I believe that value chains are great tools that investors and school owners can be referred to in order to understand the real values behind this kind of operation on ground, personified by activities, mainly academic, operational, and financial. So it is about the process of learning and achievement. A school is there as a campus with facilities, is established for students' learning and well-being. Teachers and staff get recruited for the same target, students' learning and well-being. Parents pay fees also for the same target, students' learning and well-being. So learning here is the key. Therefore, what directs the entire process is learning. So for an investor owner, it is easier when we direct attention to that value chain from an educational vantage point. Primary almost becomes support and vice versa. So when you look at the bottom purple line with those primary activities, we have leadership, readiness and strategic school improvement planning. We have professional development of teachers, readiness and enrichment programs that are always continuous. We have curriculum instruction and assessment, resources, research and operations. We also have extracurricular activities, counseling and health counseling as well. And of course, we have quality control and KPIs. What supports all this is something totally different. It's of course the human resources, recruitment and retention, which must be strategic. Infrastructure, systems and general management, including of course IT, inbound logistics, inventories, procurement, maintenance, and all of these operations. And of course, marketing and promoting brand, although this may not be really needed in this age of social media, multiple social media resources, when the school truly proves itself as effective. So what are some existing scenarios that continued during COVID, which we really have to look at? Scenario number one, when the owner does not have a strong background of education and its intricacies, and that what leads to what we call a silo leadership. So the result of this is flaws in decision-making, and this kind of scenario is mainly initiated by a potential investor or a school owner or an investor. And the thinking concept behind that, or the bias, we can name it as domain dependence, which means what is mastered in one field, in this case business, cannot be clearly transferred to another field, which is academics. So here in this case, academics need to intervene and make decisions. Scenario number two, when the community makes judgment on schools, even by word of mouth. And of course, the result here is jeopardizing school reputation and losses in population schools. Such a scenario is initiated by a community, the inner community, outer community, and the concept or the bias behind this is what we call a salient effect. And this means what highly draws our attention might not be the most important factor that we have to tend to. So we neglect in this case, the hidden discrete factors that are more effective. Scenario number three, when teachers do not like to renew contracts in the school, and of course, parents complain that that continuously we have new teachers teaching their children. And the result and the impact here, of course, is jeopardizing achievement, learning losses, and losses in population in the school. And such a scenario is initiated by the leadership and the human resource strategies. The bias or the thinking concept of problem here is alternative paths when there are risks that are not seen by us and factors that we take for granted simply because we have convinced ourselves with something different. Now, more to that is post-COVID scenarios right now. So scenario number four, not attending to the five focus urgencies, which I specify considering what the schools are going through right now in post-COVID, accountability, achievement, great achievement losses, professional development, inclusion, and human cooperation. And of course, this is also jeopardizing student achievement, causing more learning losses and more loss also in population in schools. Such a scenario is definitely initiated by leadership, general community, and the pandemic at this kind of stage. And the thinking bias is the omission bias, which is simply deliberate inaction when we know what we have to do and we are simply not doing that. And this is absolutely unacceptable in this post-COVID stage. So let's all reshape those scenarios. It's time to change. We cannot fully close the gap between aspirations and reality, but we have to reduce it. So thank you so much for listening. And I wish that we truly know the values in all industries, especially in education, because it is the basic in everything. Thank you so much.
Manal, thank you so much. Thank you. I really do appreciate your input. And of course, we call for a support for education, as it will provide society with the values that will help us build a resilient recovery from COVID-19.